focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable. Foresight Group International, Ravi K Mehrotra, an Indian's journey to global leadership.
Hello and welcome to this very special show. The Indian economy has been termed as resilient to external pressures and is expected to grow at about 7.5% in 2019, according to the Moody's macro outlook. Urban and rural demand, as well as industrial activity, are expected to support this growth. So needless to say that the India growth story is only set to become bigger and better in the years to come. And so it is but natural that opportunities in various sectors of India are going to continue to shine. And one group that's aiming to tap some of these opportunities significantly while also contributing to nation building is London-based foresight-group International. And now I'm in conversation with the founder and the executive chairman of the group, Ravi K Mehrotra, who is in fact planning to invest over $500 million into the Indian market in the next couple of years. Ravi, thank you so much for joining us on the show today. Welcome to CNBC TV 18 and welcome to India as well. First up, let's begin from the beginning. You were a sailor with the Shipping Corporation of India, a marine engineer as well. You moved from India to the UK in 1984. You started the Foresight Group. What made you turn entrepreneur? And from the shipping business, you are now into many businesses. Take us through some of the key milestones.
Yes, I started like anyone with ambition, a business. So as I started with very little money, because my father was professor of economics in Kanpur, so my family could afford only to give me the education. After that, everything is self-made. And I am very happy that me or my group does not owe or own any favors from anyone in the world.
But was entrepreneurship always in your plans?
I didn't know what is entrepreneurship in that road. Everyone starts with the basic, the roti kapla makan basis. And I wanted to do it so that my family can be secured. I only had learned in my life how to do hard work and intelligent work. And that is what I kept on focusing. So I started as a ship financial and technical broker. So those ship owners who were willing to buy the ships, how to help them to reach to the right conclusion. That gave me the sweat money to create my own equity. And myself, my wife was not very frugal, so we saved the money and started developing the company.
And in what year did you own your first ship, and today how large is your fleet?
I started in 1984 and I owned my first ship was 1986 January, because that's the ambition of a shipping man. So that was my focus, how to become a ship owner.
And today, how many ships do you own?
But I had more than 30 ships of ours. But just before 2008, I was lucky. I sold my bulk of the fleet. And then within 5 weeks, the financial crisis came.
Happened, yeah.
The reason was, I was the world's third largest refrigerated ship operator. That is where it is quite a exclusive business, because refrigerated ships, if you're carrying frozen, it is very simple, but if you're carrying fruit, it's very difficult. The reason is, if the liquid inside a fruit gets by mistake frozen, then the taste gets changed. So you have to maintain a fruit within half degree plus minus. That's each fruit you have to develop. So it's a very accurate profession, and that is where we did. And that's because of my technical background.
Right. And then you moved on from shipping to various businesses. The Foresight Group International is now into exports, you are also into LNG, you are also into consumer retail. So what has been your strategy in tapping each of these different verticals? And a lot of them, you know, like a consumer retail brand has nothing in common with a port business. So what makes you diversify so significantly?
It is very true, but there is a reason for it. Shipping is a very cyclical in nature, because shipping is not a industry. People call it shipping industry, but basically it is a service set oriented one. You carry others' goods. You are not creating yourself. And these are cyclicalities. Sometime from this place you have a huge crop, so they are exporting, getting rid of it. Other place the iron ore demands are not there. Then these are. So that cyclicality, this is one of the reasons why the shipping companies generally do not survive very long. All right. I had to safeguard the group from that because of my ambition and vision.
So today, what's the global presence of the group like?
Group, without trying to blow my own trumpet, but I am the most famous face in shipping in the world today.
What are the various markets that you operate in, if you take all of your businesses together?
Throughout world. If you are shipping centric, you cannot choose the market, because no goods which you ship is a 365 days business. Right. So you have to be the world centric. And that's the reason I move around the world and I am fully aware.
And how important and crucial is India in your business plans, whether it's your shipping business, your port development business, or your consumer retail business? And I'll delve into each of those separately, but to just give us an overview, please tell us how crucial is the Indian market? We are a billion plus people and the whole world is looking at us as an opportunity right now.
India economy is at a threshold. If the stability as it has been continues in the future, the next 5 years, India will come out of the most of the economic miseries and will start growing very fast. Will probably the growth will be in double digits. Why? Okay, stability of the government, but the youth of the nation. I understand, I don't know exactly, but more than 55% are below 35 year olds in India.
Almost 65%.
65%. See, you proved me wrong and totally very true. With that, all this, the world says there's a lot of bureaucracy in India, there's that, and it is not the right place for working. But the youth will, the moment we come out of the basic necessities, the youth will demolish everything, they will grow. Their ambition will take us. So that's the time I want my group to be there.
Right, absolutely opportune time to be here in India. So where are you planning to put these $500 million? What are the sectors that you're targeting for investment?
First, you have to understand, future for India is not in coal, not in fuel oil, but has to be cleaner fuel.
Right.
India and the world is not ready.
Is that an investment area that you're looking
True.
At? What other investment areas are you looking at apart from clean energy?
Clean energy is the main effect is between now and for the next 50 years is the gas, because it is nearly 60% cleaner than the alternative fuels. So gas has to go. So we are focusing on developing a port and a LNG. That is where liquid natural gas, that is where India will need it to burn that. We are already ship owners, so we have no problem to bring the LNG ships here. In fact, we took part in the Gas Authority of India's last tender for building LNG ships. But somehow they did not take it and finally it was cancelled. I would have entered 2 years back, but it was cancelled. Now we have decided to enter on our own.
Mm-hmm. All right. And you're also planning to add 5 VLCCs to your fleet.
Yes.
And dedicated to the Indian market. Why is that? What sort of opportunity are you seeing here? And what is the timeline you've set for adding these 5 very large crude containers?
India is already a major player in import of crude oil. We are the third largest importer of crude oil, because India only produces 900,000 barrels a day, below 1 million. And India consumes at this moment nearly 6.5 million barrels of oil. So 5.2 million barrels every day has to be imported by India. And that's the reality. And it has to be financed.
And all of these 5 VLCCs are expected to be added by 2019?
Yes, please. Maybe more. Okay. VLCC is very large crude carrier. Yes. It carries 2 million barrels of oil. And India already is importing 5.2 million barrels a day. And it is increasing by 1.9 million barrels every year. So, and Indian VLCCs are only 3-4 of their own. So, I'm not taking away business from any of them.
Yeah.
I'm
You're
only
seeing the opportunity.
Adding
right.
to them.
Right. All right. And India has also been climbing places in the World Bank's Ease of Doing Business Index. You've been invested in India for a while now. You've had 2 rigs with ONGC for a number of years. Would you say that the business environment has changed in the recent past? And would you really say that the ease of doing business has significantly improved at the grassroots level?
Now, I am running the 2 jack-up rigs, whom I have named Vivekan and Sirith, with ONGC Bombay. And the payment system is so efficient. On the dot date, electronically the money gets transferred to our account. What else an entrepreneur needs if the payments are...
It's a lot more transparent.
A lot more. And exit policy. So if the contract is not given, I can take back my rig to some other country.
All right. Good to hear that you're happy with the business environment in India. And on that note, we are going to head into a short break right now. But stay with us as the conversation with Ravi Mehrotra of Foresight Group International continues right here on CNBC TV 18 after a very short break.
Foresight Group International, Ravi K Mehrotra, an Indian's journey to global leadership.
Welcome back to our special show. Today, I'm in conversation with Ravi K. Mehrotra, the founder and executive chairman of Foresight Group International from London. It's a diversified business conglomerate with interests in shipping, ports, liquid natural gas, and consumer retail. Ravi, we've spoken a lot about your shipping business and your interest in developing ports in India. Let's now shift gears and talk a little bit about the consumer retail brand that you have. Pavers England, it's a premium footwear brand that you have here in India, and you've had it for the last decade. You've just completed 10 successful years here. So how has the consumer uptake to the brand evolved over the last couple of years, and how do you see it scaling up in the next few years?
So I persuaded the group to go into consumer market, because that is something which will continue perpetually, humans' requirement. So we decided to go into the shoe marketing. And we had no experience, so I went and joined. I knew the family, Pavers family from York and UK.
Yeah.
And I proposed, they were very happy. And they became our partner. We came in 2008 here. We developed and kept on losing money because there were very few buyers of that. But this was the first quality product shoes available on international standard in India.
And yet you continued to suffer the losses.
Yes.
And
but the group could take that losses because we knew what is the future going to be. And if I had started this shoe business now, it would have been very difficult for people to accept the brand. But today I am happy to say, with 34 shoe shops across, mainly we have focused the airport, so that those who are well-to-do can afford to buy, and they get 30 minutes free time at the airport to buy. We developed that USP, telling them you can leave the other shoe or the new shoe and we'll deliver at your home. So that is how it caught up.
And is the business profitable now?
Yes. And we expect in next 2 years, our stores will become 100.
You're headquartered at London. Let's talk a little bit about the business environment there, especially for Indian businesses. A number of Indian startups are setting up shop there. You have a deputy mayor of business who is Indian or of Indian origin at least. So tell us a little bit about what the business environment is like. And secondly, post-Brexit, have things changed? Has it impacted your business at all?
As a prudent chairman for a group, you have to take these into account and take corrective measures. So we moved the real headquarters of that 2 years back to Mauritius. All right. So because we don't know where the UK will go, and there will be 4 or 5 years of turmoil, no matter what it is. Headquarters of the group are Mauritius, and regular operative office is in Dubai now. London remains because the chairman sits there. Everyone in the world recognizes London. But if it was, this had come 20 years back, I would have faced the problem. But now the group is so well diversified and recognized, it does not matter where you shift.
Right.
I will give you an example. When UK was handing over Hong Kong to China in 1997, about 1994, HSBC Bank, which was headquartered in Hong Kong, decided to move to London. They could not easily move in China. So what they did, they bought the Midland Bank and merged it, and then say this is the headquarters. That is how HSBC Bank became a British bank.
So you'd moved before Brexit to Mauritius?
Yes, 3 years back, I said. We moved it. So we will not be impacted by that. And it gives us also at the right moment proximity of Mauritius with India and the Mauritius population being Indian. So it is good for India-centric if the group becomes that.
Yes, and I believe you're also exploring opportunities in the artificial intelligence space, one of the emerging technologies that is bound to change our future. What sort of opportunities are you seeking there, and are you looking to invest in that area?
Our approach is totally different than the simplified form which is being hyped throughout the world. Because digitalization, etc., the youth of the world will create very easy, and their shelf life will not be much. So we are not looking there, that we can buy them what we need. What I am looking is deep learning, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. What we have, our oil rigs and ships are working over 99% efficiency, all of them. That means I have a huge experience behind in the group. We want that to be captured in the artificial intelligence, so that whatever system we create
is efficient.
That experience, this will be lost in the world with the artificial intelligence taking over. If we don't do this, it is at the cost of group's health. Thank you.
Great. And finally, you're also an author. You wrote a book called What's in It for You that has a lot of life lessons for young people. So what is that one quality as a successful entrepreneur that you pick up from your 10 mantras in that book and apply every day of your life?
I have created the 10 main points in my book. Basically, the book I wrote is not a biography. It is the lesson. I created this book for the Harvard and the Cambridge University of this world.
Right.
to analyze me, what I have done in my life, right or wrong. This is the main point. And I believe...
Your one mantra for success.
Hard work and keep faith in yourself.
Okay. Thank you so much, Mr. Mehrotra. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Well, with that, it's a wrap of this special show. Hope you enjoyed that insightful conversation. Thanks for joining us. Goodbye.
Foresight Group International, Ravi K. Mehrotra, an Indian's journey to global leadership. Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.